in the spirit of the internet, we are completely transparent, so we will be live cast, which means that whenever you take the floor, please wait until you have the microphone to be really also understood by the outside world. Welcome again here at the World Economic Forum. As you know, we are an impartial, not-for-profit, informal institution engaged in many projects of public-private cooperation. I just would like to mention our engagement in the climate sector, in infrastructure, and so on. But today, we are here for something which is particularly crucial for the future of mankind. The internet is a shared global resource. And for over 25 years, it has served as a key tool for social, political, and economic development, contributing to human solidarity and creating an opportunity, creating empowerment as a platform also for innovation. The value that the internet has provided is beyond any doubt. But what is most exciting is what's yet to come, the unrealized potential of the internet to help to address the critical issues, the critical global issues which are at the center of our future. Building on that progress that has been already made and creating an ecosystem where the internet can further develop is therefore vital for all of us. But as the world becomes more interconnected, it is also becoming much more and increasingly complex. Issues such as privacy, data protection, fragmentation of regulation, human rights are increasingly affecting, of course, all our lives, individually and collectively. Because the internet is a shared global resource, we must find ways to address those challenges so that we can be confident that its positive benefits continue to outweigh the challenges. This discussion should not be confined to the agendas of governments or civil society alone or business alone. What we need is a true global multi-stakeholder interaction. Good progress is being made in this area. Under the leadership of the Brazilian government, and here I must congratulate particularly my neighbor and thank you, Minister Almeida, for having organized the NETmundial in Sao Paulo in April this year, which articulated the key principles in advance of such a stakeholder governance model. Our aim today is to carry forward the spirit which you have created in order to first bring together the people necessary to strengthen understanding, to enhance trust, and to identify the areas which provide common ground for cooperation. But second, we also must galvanize support for building capacity, helping developing countries to enhance their access and the governance of the internet. The press of issues the internet is facing requires a wider set of stakeholders than ever before. This is day one of a journey. The objective is clear. Mapping the issues and moving from issue identification to solutions identification and the definition of best practices. The process which starts today, following your first footstep, is a completely transparent and open one. We all want to bind together, to bound together, and to build together the internet as a public good. This requires the engagement of all stakeholders of the global community, so well represented in this room. But through the internet, this room is not closed. We invite every global citizen to join the journey. I would like to thank particularly all the representatives of internet-related organizations who have joined us today. I want to thank particularly Fadi Jihadi, President and CEO of ICANN. Our goal is in no way to substitute the essential and important work all those organizations are doing, but rather, in the best spirit of the forum, to serve as a catalyst, integrator, and platform, providing a base for the so much necessary collaboration. In this respect, I also want to thank for their presence here all the representatives of governments, of business, and of course, of civil society. It is my great pleasure that these discussions are placed under the chairmanship of a person who, particularly in the internet, but also in the world, of course, is so well known for his engagement in and his personal commitment to the internet, not only of yourself, Mr. President Ilves, but I think, if I'm not mistaken, your country is one of the best interconnected through the internet in the world. So please welcome President Ilves in his, I would say, challenging task, which we all will very much facilitate during the next 2 hours.
Well, thank you very much. Yes, I'm the facilitator here, which probably means that I have to sort of grease the wheels and also apply the brakes if things get out of hand. Let me just say, just on the technical side, I would ask everyone to keep their comments to 2 minutes because we have so many people here, not so much time, and if we really want to have a good discussion. And my general rule running meetings is that the longer you talk, the less you're listened to. Now, just to put things in context, 55 years ago, a British, Oxford biologist, scientist, but also poet named C.P. Snow wrote an essay called The Two Cultures about the fact that people in science and technology don't really know anything about anything soft in the humanities, and the people in the soft areas, including things like human rights and so forth, have no idea of technology and science. And this has not really become a problem. I mean, it was kind of a nice intellectual thing that we all, well, some of us read in university and so forth. We have now come to the collision of these two cultures. Spurred on, I guess we could all admit, by the revelations last year of what NSA was doing. But today we're in a world where we have the sort of the rights, the sort of social side of NETmundial dealing with how we approach this new world. And then we have the technical side of how do we actually manage the internet? What is it that we're doing? Distributing DNS, and all of that is the technical side. And we have to bring these two together. I mean, we have to get an understanding of each other, because if we don't, we will go on in the same way that we have, in which the technical people say, oh boy, look what I can do with this, not really understanding that maybe what you're doing is morally or legally incorrect. On the other hand, I have also, in my experiences, for example, talking to the European Parliament, experience that people who don't understand the technology do not understand what is possible, what is not possible, make vast claims about what is possible, and at the same time are not willing to make use of technologies in the way that are now available that were not even 10 years ago. So anyway, I just wanted to say that because that is, I think, the goal of this, because basically there have been two important initiatives. The Sao Paulo NETmundial initiative, which looked at the broader ethical, moral, legal, social side of what is going on in the internet, and it was about time that finally someone sat down or called together people to do this, because it was just proceeding apace without really sort of having an understanding. And then similarly, also inspired by developments last year, Fadeh was sort of realized that, you know, we really have to address these issues head on, because that too had just been sort of moving along nicely, scientifically, technologically, but again, to take into account the issues that were done by NETmundial. So I see this meeting today as the first major step forward in trying to bring these two together so that we're not talking at cross purposes. So we can think of this as the sort of C.P. Snow Memorial meeting, that we are bringing everyone together and hope to move on. And that's my piece for now. After this, I will turn into the whip-cracking slave driver. But just to make sure that, to start off, I'll give first the floor to Virgilio Almeida, who's Secretary for Information Technology Policy in the Ministry of Science, Technology, and Innovation in Brazil, and of course, better known among us as the chairman of the NETmundial meeting. And then Virgilio will speak for 5 to 7 minutes, and then similarly, Fadeh Chahari from ICANN can also talk. So please.
Well, thank you for...
Oh, one last thing I say. When you get the microphone, wait a minute. Don't start talking immediately, because it'll be turned on for you, and then it will be webcast to the people who can. So.
Can I start now? Okay, thank you for your kind words, and good morning to everyone. I would like to greet Your Excellence, Mr. Thomas Ives, President of Estonia, Dr. Klaus Schwab, founder of the World Economic Forum, and Mr. Fadeh Chahari, President and CEO of ICANN. It's a pleasure to be here in this beautiful city of Geneva in this beautiful day. Thanks for this scenario. Ladies, gentlemen, and friends, I'm going to start this talk by quoting the President of Brazil, Dilma Rousseff, in her speech at the opening session of NETmundial that was held in Sao Paulo. She proposed important directions for the evolution of the global internet governance ecosystem. At one point of her speech, she said, "We have all come to Sao Paulo, therefore, with a shared purpose of enhancing and democratizing internet governance by means of consensus building. And I mean consensus around principles and on a roadmap to be developed for its future evolution." A point that I would like to make plain and clear is that the idea here is not, of course, to replace for the countless fora out there that already address the topic or the matter at hand today. The idea, rather, is to lend a new momentum to the ongoing discussions in a much needed sense of urgency. Two aspects of the president's speech called my attention and could help to set the context for the discussions here today. The sense of urgency and the need to integrate the NETmundial initiative with other initiatives and fora that address internet governance. This is something that we must work during this period of creation of the new initiative. In another part of the president's Dilma speech, she said, "In order for the global internet governance to be truly democratic, mechanisms are required to enable great participation of developing countries in all different actors. The matters that are in the interest of these countries that are heavy-duty users of the internet, such as expanding connectivity, accessibility, and the respect to diversity, should be central to the international agenda. It is not enough for FORA to be open from a purely formal standpoint. We must further identify and remove the visible and invisible barriers to actual participation of the entire population of every country, or else we would be ultimately restricting or limiting the democratic role and the social and cultural reach of the internet. She emphasized the importance of constructing concrete mechanisms that help developing countries, or global south, as some people call, to actively participate of the global internet governance process. In addition to the points raised by our president, I would like to emphasize other issues related to internet governance. As chairman of the Brazilian Internet Steering Committee, CGI, that has been in operation for 20 years, I would say that one of the reasons for its success is the fact that CGI has relied on actual participation of representatives from civil society, members of academia, the business community, and the government at large. The experience of CGI has proved that an open, transparent, participatory, inclusive, and multi-stakeholder internet governance process pays off. These are central values that I would like to see incorporated into the process of creation of the NETmundial initiative. Having said this introduction, I want now to address the following question. What do I expect from the NETmundial initiative? As you all know very well, the internet has promoted deep changes in standards of living, work, education, entertainment, political participation, and above all, the way that we interact with each other. With almost 3 billion users worldwide, the internet and the web have become a general purpose technology, a basic and essential element in the life of almost every citizen and a key component of governments and the economy. However, on the other side of the coin are challenges, such as cybercrime, cyberbullying, security threats, attacks on freedom of expression and human rights, invasion of privacy, espionage, and transnational legal disputes. Many of these issues are related to the global internet governance. As many of these issues, such as privacy, bullying, etc., impose pressures on countries that do not know how to handle them. Due to the internet's decentralized and multi-stakeholder nature, which involves governments, companies, civil society, and the academic and technical communities, the internet cannot be regulated or governed only at the national level. Internet governance needs local, regional, and global agreements and governance systems. Internet governance may need new mechanisms to handle the challenges of the massification of internet services and the problems that are brought by this massification. Two recent initiatives shed light on new issues in the global scenario of internet governance, NETmundial and the High-Level Panel on the Future of Internet Governance. The High-Level Panel, led by President Ives, consists of a group of global stakeholders. These two initiatives came up with several proposals for enhancing the global internet governance ecosystem, with the clear goal of preserving a unified internet that is unfragmented, interconnected, interoperable, open, inclusive, secure, stable, resilient, and trustworthy. For me, NETmundial initiative is a process under construction. Is a process that should be built on the results and experience of NETmundial and the High-Level Panel and other forums. It should be based on some fundamental pillars that have been constructed by different existing internet governance forums. The first one is the set of principles approved by NETmundial that states that internet governance should be multi-stakeholder, open, participative, consensus-driven, transparent, accountable, inclusive, equitable, distributed, collaborative, and accessible with low barriers and agile. The next 2 years will therefore be crucial to redrawing the map of internet governance. Together with IGF, ITU, and IANA Transition Committee, NETmundial initiative, if properly engineered, can be an important player in the internet governance global scenario. In order to succeed, the NETmundial initiative must follow key requirements of the multi-stakeholder process. A key element in multi-stakeholder models is the adoption of a bottom-up and equal footing approach that should permeate the process of constructing this new initiative. The organizers should also keep in mind the need to tailor the process to the multi-stakeholders' specificities, such as decision timing, representativeness, and language. By committing to these values, the NETmundial initiative can earn an early vote of credibility from the global internet community and can achieve international legitimacy, which is a mandatory characteristic to make internet governance multi-stakeholder decision process viable and doable. To conclude, I think this Geneva meeting is the beginning of a process of constructing new mechanisms to enrich the global internet governance ecosystem, which is vital to the strengthening of cyberspace and its use for the social and economic development of all nations. For the preservation of its dynamism, internet governance must continue its quest for innovation through an open, participative, inclusive, and multi-stakeholder environment. Thank you all.
Thank you. Just keep time going, I'll immediately give floor to Father Chaid.
Thank you, Mr. President. Professor Schwab, thank you for inviting us here. Secretary Almeida, thank you for your kind words and being here. I am Fadi Shahadi. Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for joining us on this very historic day. Let me start by saying that we are entering a phase in internet governance that is going to be distinct from what we've seen to date. And we need a change of gears at this stage. BCG predicts that next year the digital economy in the G20 economies will pass $4 trillion. This is now a significant part of the world economy. The internet has changed lives and continues to empower people around the world. The developing world needs the internet. All of us need the internet. But the term cyberspace, which we've used for many years, I've declared recently, is dead. Cyberspace is dead. All space is now cyber. It permeates every part of our lives. And it needs some governance, and it needs some rules. Today, we build on the great work that was done by a multi-stakeholder meeting in Sao Paulo in April. At that meeting, we agreed together on a set of principles to govern the internet. At the top of these principles is the principle of human rights and its importance for the internet, and its importance as a central core part of how we together use and manage the internet. From Sao Paulo, we went to the panel chaired by President Ilves, and in that panel, we first endorsed the Sao Paulo principles, but went a step further. We actually created a framework and proposed it to the world for the governance of the internet, a framework that we called a distributed framework of internet governance. Now, distributed is a key word here, because in the 21st century, to govern something like the internet that is so transnational in nature, the standard model of governance that we all know are being challenged with the internet. The internet crosses jurisdictions, it crosses boundaries, and it calls on us to think of a new model of governance. Let's call it a distributed, networked model of governance that requires actors from all walks and all sectors to come together in fast constellations that address issues. Now, when you think networked and you think constellations of parties, you think immediately the World Economic Forum. This is what the Forum has done brilliantly for years. This is what they're offering right now for internet governance. They're offering their fantastic formula of open discussion of networked parties to come together to leverage the resources of the world to solve big issues. Now, many of you in this room, I know, and you may be asking, so what is going to be different about this initiative? We've had many meetings. We have other forums. Many of us in a couple of days are heading to Istanbul to the Internet Governance Forum. So what is different here? Let me clarify the following. My hope and our vision together, I hope, after today's meeting, should be that this initiative catalyzes our issues and dialogues into action. This is what we need to think about. How do we go from the great recommendations of Sao Paulo and principles that we agreed on to the superb framework that was put forth by President Ilves Panel into actual solutions? So we have many forms and many capabilities to identify issues. Now we have principles to solve them. So let's solve them. This initiative is about catalyzing us towards starting to solve the real issues. And let's be candid. There are many unsolved issues. I can say, as the president of ICANN, that ICANN maybe has a place to address technical issues related to names and numbers and protocol parameters. The IETF has equally a working and successful model for solving certain technical issues. The W3C, represented here by Sir Tim Berners-Lee, the inventor of the World Wide Web, also has proven to be a great place to solve these technical issues. But there are many other issues that are not solved. Issues that require attention by all of us at the grassroots who've worked very hard for many years, and many decision makers who need to be brought into that. Because as the president said, sometimes, to be direct, not all decision makers are well informed. They're not brought into these issues. The World Economic Forum gives us the opportunity to bring them into that mix, to make them part of the solution. I want to particularly thank today the presence of a representative of Secretary General Wu Hongbo, the Secretary General of UNDESA. Leah Armstrong is here on his behalf, and the chairman of the IGF MAG, Ambassador Yanis Karklans, who's with us as well. Thank you, Ambassador. Because from the beginning, we wanted to be clear that what we're doing here is completely complementary to the great work of the IGF. Many of us who are in this room will be heading to Istanbul to support the IGF and make the IGF the success it needs to be and continues to be. And they're here because of the partnership. We have clearly extended our arms to them, saying the NETmundial initiative needs to go to the IGF, learn the issues in the IGF that are multi-stakeholder discussed, and then take these and move them into solutioning. And I will say for the WEF, because I have been very engaged with Dr. Schwab and with Rick Sammons, the managing director, leading to today, that the WEF does not intend to be the place where solutions are made. This is not a normative environment. This is a place that enables. Think of them as the soil, the good soil, where we, after years of hard work, can come and plant our issues and our trees and work with them and have them help us catalyze the global community and the decision makers so that we can solve these problems together. And finally, I just would like to say that if we do not move into action now, the internet is going to be challenged to stay the way we know it today. One internet for the world that is a public good, as Dr. Schwab said, is under challenge. Fragmentation could happen politically. It could happen at the policy level. It could happen at the private level, because many corporations are starting to think that maybe the internet without enough rules, maybe a need for them to separate and have private internets. ISPs are also concerned about the rise of issues and attacks on the internet. There are real issues we're facing. To save the internet from fragmentation and hand it to the next generation as an empowering, civil, and secure platform should be our mission, and I hope we succeed. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'd call on three speakers, and to begin with, I would say that if everything we have accomplished in the last 6 years, 600 years can be attributed to the invention of movable type by Gutenberg, then, and of course, technology has changed completely since what he invented, I guess, in Mainz, but 600 years from now, there'll be two names that will be known for starting it all off, Vint Cerf and the TCP/IP protocol. And the other person is Tim Berners-Lee, the inventor of the hypertext transfer protocol, and that is the HTTP before every address you ever go on the internet. Please, I'll give you the floor.
Thank you. So thank you, Mr. President Klaus. Thank you for inviting us all here. So I must say, for me, this is something I'm interested in. I'm interested to watch it. Hopefully interested to make sure you don't all do something disastrously wrong. Coming from, so in fact, looking across the lake, if you look a little to the left, there is CERN, where I actually proposed the web 25 years ago. And for most of that 25 years, the organizations I've worked with have been the technical ones. The Internet Engineering Task Force was around before then, and the WTC, which I formed in order to provide a forum where people would come to agree on the technology. So at that point, the thing which was really important was you had global agreement that when the computers talk to each other, they talk to the same languages. That was necessary to keep the web one web as it spread. Now it's very large. Over the last, the consortium is now 20 years old. Jeff Jaffe is here, who runs it. Over that 20 years, it has moved from being a place where geeks only come to talk about really cool things that they could do, really cool, exciting, powerful things, to come to talk about how the things that they're designing always have a social part. They always have a policy implication. Sometimes they write a piece of code, they design a new piece of the technology, and that immediately has a policy implication. It immediately destroys or improves privacy. It immediately makes the web more centralized or less centralized. Sometimes it has the potential to make a huge social change, but can only be done in collaboration with social change, with legislative changes. So things like, for example, the famous do not track header, which people have been trying to put together to give users option of more privacy. It's difficult to do just by writing the code. You also have to have a whole lot of agreement about what that code will mean. So bit by bit, during these last 25 years, it's been fascinating to see and to participate in the growth of this ecosystem of more and more different organizations which have participated. It's been interesting to come to Davos, but I have to say that for me, to a certain extent, all the internet groups and Davos were in different categories. Davos was the place to make sure that the powerful heads of industry and the powerful heads of government are all understand and can go away and talk to each other about best practice. So yes, it is. But Davos was certainly arm's length from most of where sort of the rubber hit the road when it came to the technological change and the policy changes which were advancing the internet. So is it logical to connect these two worlds? Yes. When a multi-stakeholder world, whenever there are you have two communities which seem to be becoming from different places, it is really important, and it is in general very valuable to connect them. So I'm very grateful for this for Fadi, Klaus, for you putting this initiative together. I am, as always, skeptical about things. I think we have to be very careful about keeping things open, and it's great that this is being live streamed. Openness, by the way, means openness to output, input as well as output. And as you said, Freddie, one of the really interesting questions coming up is how we build these big decentralized governance systems. Certainly, I know at W3C, we've 20 years of experience, and we're constantly learning. I think that we will get more experience as we try to find out how to make a group like this sitting around in this room in a way accountable to a system which can take input from all of the experts out there and all of the concerned individuals. Building that sort of thing is going to be a huge challenge. Yes, it's really, really important because, yes, as the guy, there was a recent, a couple of days ago, article in The Guardian pointed out, we may be losing, or we may already be losing, the openness and the qualities of the internet which we had all assumed that we would have. I hope we're not too late. I hope that we do manage, like the Web Foundation has, Angela Murray is here too, from the Web Foundation. The Web Foundation has been trying to make sure that that all we do is eventually is in response to very high level, human rights level policies. We've talked about a Magna Carta for the internet. I hope that we can, everybody here can be part of the process which puts together that Magna Carta and then implements it in the years to come. Thank you.
And now we have, where is she? Sorry. Carolina Rossini, Vice President of International Policy at Public Knowledge. If she's not here.
I'm here, thank you. So good morning, everybody, and thank you so much to really try hard and involve civil society as soon as possible in this gathering. My name is Carolina Rossini, and I'm actually from Brazil, working now in a US-based public interest organization that works with digital rights and consumer and human rights on the cross with technology. In Brazil, I found and collected a lot of work on open educational resources, also training civil society and policymakers on issues regarding the internet. I have to say that I do not represent civil society as a whole, but actually I am part of a series of coalitions and projects that do have very similar concerns. And I'm follow here today with a series of really great leaders from civil society like Brett Solomon from Access, Eileen from Human Rights Watch, Jeremy from EFF, and many others. The NETmundial multi-stakeholder statement makes clear in its first process principle that internet governance should be built on multi-stakeholder processes, ensuring a meaningful and accountable participation of all stakeholders. Much of the process that has brought us together caught many of us by surprise. But I think that we all hope, as others have said already, that we are here today in an honest attempt to further the outcomes of NETmundial in terms of process, as well as reaffirming our multi-stakeholder commitment to public interest and human rights-based internet governance. Has Nena Nawakauna said in her open remarks at NETmundial in Brazil, there are some core points that we still need to make sure in any process or platform that come out of this gathering. An open and inclusive process where no single stakeholder can hijack the process, cooperation and structured knowledge governance, and a transparent and accountable process that includes dialogues and debates and meaningful participation from developing countries and underrepresented groups. Each of these take not just time, but also a willingness to learn from and respect diversity of each stakeholders, their norms, their concerns, and their ways of working together. We also need to ensure that resources are mobilized and maintained for a viable internet governance mechanism, and the internet should be able to provide resources for its own governance. Our model in Brazil, the CGIBR, and we have Virgilio and Glaser here representing CGI, besides being a model for multi-stakeholderism, is actually a model for how you finance activities around the internet. And I'm very proud to say that they do that not to support their own bureaucracy, but actually to support better knowledge in Brazil around internet governance, engagement, and the training of the next leaders. So CGIBR, they do promote a series of public calls for research, for civil society projects, and also they have now a master's in the makes that are coming out hopefully soon. So I think that's a really good model to look in terms of refinancing its own system. On the substance side, I want to make three core points. Support. The NETmundial initiative should not subsume or supplant the mandates or efforts of IGF and other existing internet governance processes and coalitions. Support for this process was confirmed in both the NETmundial outcome document and the IEVES report that came out of a high-level group in ICANN. Human rights. Defending and extending human rights online should be the focus of NETmundial and at the core of its mission when we identify the issues to be addressed. Yet, human rights are only mentioned once in the briefing document and a passing in the FAQ and not at all in today's agenda, but I'm glad it was mentioned by many of you. The NETmundial initiative should work within the framework set out by the UN Human Rights Council and reasserted in the NETmundial outcome document, which makes clear that human rights are universal and the rights of people have offline must be protected online. Finally, as a third point, I would foster us and would like to engage with you to actually not repeat or recreate or the wheel, right? We need to engage in processes that already business, civil society, and governments are converging in. And some of these processes are the Magna Carta, as Tim Berners-Lee mentioned, and Marco Civil in Brazil has been serving as an example for that. The necessary and proportionate principles that also has been serving as the base of the reform of privacy and surveillance system in the US and in other countries. And some of the efforts around the ICT guide on implementing business principles and human rights. So I think those are three initiatives that this platform should serve as a megaphone. To close, we must identify the medium to long-term goals of the NETmundial initiative. Specifically, we need to clarify NETmundial initiative added value, specific purpose, and clearly identifiable and achievable goals that is going to set for itself. And I think Brett put it that brilliantly in his post from yesterday. But for that to be successful, we need to ensure a participatory, transparent, open, and accountable process supported by technology that already exists. We have platforms that enable participation. The open government efforts and also the NETmundial initiative efforts have a diversity of examples of those platforms, where voices from both the North and South can provide input. And I hope this will not be defective by design. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And hello. Thank you. And now I'd like to ask the CEO of Accenture, Pierre Nantem, to say a few words, and I just say that we've worked together before on the European Commission Cloud Strategy Group and was a significant and very important contributor there, and I'm very grateful for his participation there, and I'm sure he'll have much to add here.
Thank you very much, Mr. President, and it's a pleasure to be with you again, my friend Jim as well, Agreement Nabi, and I remember all the work and the effort we've been doing in Europe, and it's just an illustration of what it is we need to do from a multi-stakeholder standpoint to come together and work hard, but smart, to try to find solution to something which is probably one of the most complex and critical issues from a business, regulatory, and government standpoint we have to face in the 21st century. So I'm delighted to be here and to be part of this initiative. Most of the time, people believe that business is against regulation, is against governance, and we want to let things go free. In that context, I'm speaking on behalf of the business, and I'm the chairman as well of the IT governance for the WEF, dear Klaus. We believe, and the business believe, and I guess, Jim, you would agree with me, that internet governance is absolutely critical for the business if we want this incredible opportunity to move on, moving forward, and bring the benefits we all expect to improve the way the world works and live. So I would say the business is rallying the cause of the internet governance. The business opportunity, and today I'm a little bit the voice of the business, I guess, not only is huge as we speak today, but is growing every minute of every day. As Accenture CEO, needless to say that nearly every conversation I have with CEOs, with head of governments, is all about digital one way or the other. It should be around the business, it should be around the infrastructure, it should be around the technology, and it's pervasive across each and every industry in the planet. And as we all know, it's not only from a business to consumer, and this is probably where the internet magic started to serve the consumer, but now the opportunity from a business-to-business standpoint and business-to-government standpoint is as well growing in a way which is just amazing. And from an Accenture standpoint, of course, this is by far the fastest growing part of our business. But all of this digital opportunity assumes a foundation based on trusted, safe, and secure internet. It will be impossible to continue growing and deliver against the promise if we are not providing an environment of trust, safe, and secure for the internet. Today, just amazing, this last few months, what's happening in the with the opportunity from a business standpoint, and I was just gathering a couple of illustrations without being too long, but just on what we've been doing with a couple of organizations from an Accenture standpoint. Singapore Ministry of Health, and we talked about the health opportunity from an internet standpoint to change the way a patient going to be served. We helped the Ministry of Health build and operate its national electronic health record system, and they've been going fully digital in this country, and that's certainly something that could change the way the world is living. I'm thinking about what has been happening between Belgacom and BNP Paribas in the country of Belgium, where we supported building the first mobile wallet enabling secure shopping and payment via smartphone. Again, another way to change the way people are living. And finally, maybe the last example for Fiat and Chrysler. In automotive, leveraging mobility capabilities to bring customers new innovation to improve the security and the safety in cars. So when you look at this, it's going far beyond what we used to call the e-commerce to really now impact the lives of the people. You're mentioning that the e-commerce is almost today an $8 trillion transaction every year. It's almost peanuts if you look at the opportunity of the industrial internet or the Internet of Things, you can almost multiply by four the impact and getting to the incredible number of $32 trillion transaction when the industrial internet is going to be. It's just going to be huge, probably even beyond our imagination. And of course, the internet governance is going to be key. So the stakes are very high, and especially yesterday in France, I'm coming from a country where we're looking for growth and jobs. And if you're looking at probably one of the single most important opportunity in the world to create growth and job is definitely through the internet. But, and I will close with that, all this goodness will come to a halt if we're doing the wrong thing. And especially if we're moving to a place of fragmentation and protectionism. I'm not going to pile on my friends and colleagues here, but for us, the biggest fear would be indeed, like in the trade, happening in internet, what might happen in the trade, fragmentation and protectionism. So I guess that our common purpose is to prevent that scenario from playing out, and this is what internet governance is all about, and it clearly deserves our attention as leaders. We have to get it right, and it's not about us, it's about the future generations, and it's about the growth and the wealth of the planet. And if I'm here today, it's because I'm a strong believer of the process we're putting in place and the spirit of the governance. I and we, from an IT governance standpoint, truly believe that the internet should be governed through a bottom-up, distributed, multi-stakeholder approach that involves open collaboration between industry, governments, academics, and civil society. We are very eager from a business standpoint to engage in the broad-based dialogue, dear Klaus, to address the key issues, and some being addressed in the effort we had on this cloud initiative in Europe, such as, of course, data protection and trust. I remember that trust was probably the word we mentioned the most for almost 2 years, dear President. Trust, trust, trust in the internet. But of course, cybersecurity, which is a huge issue, intellectual property rights, user access in developed and developing countries, which is probably one of the number one issue or risk if protectionism in fragmentation is happening, and of course, continued innovation in the internet. So couldn't be more pleased to be part of the dialogue representing the IT governors and the business.
Thank you very much. Moving along as quickly as possible now, I'm going to open it up for discussion. There are several people I will call upon as well, but whoever raises their hand first gets to speak, but please do identify yourself. One thing I just wanted to add here, just to always keep in mind, I mean, a lot of this, what we're discussing today, got started on the issue of privacy and who's looking at what. And which is clearly one of the most important issues. But the other thing that we need to also worry about is integrity. I mean, ultimately, I don't care if someone knows my blood type, but I really don't want to know if someone changes the electronic record of my blood type. And so it's not simply a matter of who's looking at you, but do they have the ability to change your own data? But now, let me turn to my Latvian colleague.
So thank you, President. Janis Karkmins, Ambassador of Latvia, Chairman of the Multi-Stakeholder Advisory Group of IGF and the former Chairman of the Preparatory Committee of the World Summit on Information Society, where internet governance was a topical issue. So very brief remarks in response and in reaction to what I heard. Let me start by saying that world and society are in permanent evolution, as well as internet governance as such. I remember the World Summit 2003-2005 talking about internet governance, first of all, spoke about completely different internet that we know today, and spoke about completely different set of issues related to governance that we're addressing today. So we have today new challenges that we need to address, and it can be done through existing frameworks, through new initiatives, and the one of them we're launching today. The NETmundial itself was a groundbreaking event. It explored maybe the new horizons of multi-stakeholder decision-making, and I'm very carefully using this term multi-stakeholder decision-making because we reached agreement in a multi-stakeholder negotiations where government, civil society, industry were at the table negotiating the two texts, one on principles and one of way forward. NETmundial supported Internet Governance Forum very prominently as important platform for multi-stakeholder engagement. I think that the coming initiative coming meeting of IGF is taking the NETmundial spirit and decisions further. If we are thinking today about NETmundial 6 months after, it has gradually becoming a term of multi-stakeholder engagement more than a reference to a meeting itself. And I think that NETmundial initiative should embrace that spirit of inclusiveness and promote multi-stakeholder governance model. The reference that I heard on the regulations, of course we need the regulation, but the question is what kind of regulation and what, how we arrive to that kind of regulation, whether we arrive it through the intergovernmental only process or we arrive to it through multi-stakeholder process. And whether we're talking about centralized regulation or we're talking about decentralized regulation. I think that these are important elements that we need to contemplate when we're thinking about this initiative. And clearly, I hope that NETmundial initiative will promote what we agreed in principle in 2005, that the internet should be governed in a multi-stakeholder way. Thank you.
Thank you. And in the spirit of geographic distribution, I would, and also size, I'd say, given Latvia and Estonia, I would call on Zhao Zhenliang, Director General of the Cyberspace Administration of the People's Republic of China. Remember, 3 minutes.
Good morning, everyone. I'm from China. I'm very honored to be here, but it's a big challenge for me to speak English. I try. On behalf of Lu Wei, Minister of Cyberspace Administration of China, I'd like to extend thanks for WEF and ICANN for organizing this meeting. Excuse me. Chinese government supports the WEF and ICANN take part in internet governance and play important roles. Chinese government pays a great attention to internet and endeavors to promote internet development in China. Today, China has 632 million internet users, and internet in China has become a very important infrastructure. So Chinese citizens, enterprises, government are very concerned about internet governance. In June, the 50th ICANN meeting was held in London. On that meeting, Minister Lu Wei proposed 7 consensus and 4 principles, which have received universal welcome. I think these principles and the spirits should be absorbed in the following work. I hope by efforts from all stakeholders, we can produce an inclusive, transparent, fair, legitimate, and effective internet governance system. Thank you.
And then I call upon the gentleman there to raise his hand. Before.
Thank you very much. German books from Transparency International, but also for four years, the first independent chair of the Global Network Initiative. And in the interests of looking at perhaps some solutions on a multi-stakeholder basis to some specific issues, I thought it would be interesting to share with you very quickly what the Global Network Initiative is about. So it is a response to problems which the big ISPs, the big internet companies, found themselves confronted with in terms of freedom of expression and also their commitment to privacy of internet users. And rather than going away and hoping that the problems would disappear, they reached out to civil society, mainly the human rights civil society organizations. They reached out to globally responsible investors and also to academics such as the Berkman Institute, which is represented here. What has been done practically in terms of turning that commitment into reality is, first of all, the companies have submitted themselves to an independent assessment, which was completed in a two-phase process by the beginning of this year. Secondly, there's quite a significant amount of advocacy taking place, obviously, around the Snowden revelations, calling for both greater transparency at the government level, but also on the part of companies. And there is now a move within many of the companies to present what they call transparency reports, which is really listing country by country the number of interceptions and takedown notices that they receive on a country-by-country basis. And they're producing these fairly regularly on about a six-month basis. And finally, just to keep to my 2 minutes, advocacy activities are really quite strong. Obviously, attempts by countries to exaggerate the need for data retention. We've had quite a few examples of pushback there, both in the US and the UK. Finally, many countries need to reform their dealing with intermediary liability. Was recently in India and supported by an analysis conducted by Copenhagen Economics, we came up with the formula that the gross national product of India could increase by another 0.5% per annum if it would reform its wrongly styled and implemented intermediary liability legislation. Thank you.
Great, thank you. Now I turn to Bruce Andrews, U.S. Deputy Secretary of Commerce.
Yes. First of all, I want to thank you for convening this today. I think this is remarkably valuable and a great forum for us to come together and talk about these issues. As you know, the United States government strongly supports the multi-stakeholder process, and so convening such a group and giving everyone the opportunity to be part of a very open, inclusive process is something that's very important to us. One other priority that we feel is important is this part of this process is bridging the existing institutions and processes that already exist. What we don't need is another forum independent of all the other good work that's going on here. And so that's something that's a very high priority, and I thank you, Klaus, for your focusing on that and recognizing how important that is. And then last is looking at the needs of the users of the internet and making sure that one of the things that we focus most importantly on is how do we protect the people who are users? How do we serve their needs? And how do we make sure that what we do represents those people well as part of our process? And with that said, thank you very much for having us here today.
Great. Now, and thank you for your briefness. let me turn to Kathy Brown, CEO of ISOC. And if anyone else wants to say anything, please do raise your hand or piece of paper.
Thank you, Klaus, for inviting us. Thank you, Fadi. Thank you, President Niels. We've been on a long journey together through many years, through the birth and amazing growth of the internet. I think the Internet Society is dedicated to the internet everywhere for everyone. So as we think about these lofty notions of governance, a first priority for us is that the internet is everywhere. One of the things this great platform can do that brings together the huge companies of the world is to think about where the internet is not yet and the investment that is required to get it there. We're about to go to Turkey, many of us in this room, where over 3,000 internet users will be present, many of which want more than anything in the world to have access to this amazing tool. The governance of the internet should be all about investment, access, and innovation. The technical community of the internet stands with the people of the world who want the internet, and we are engaged in the discussions around this notion of governance. The thing about the internet that's so different than even our greatest democracies is it's not a representative kind of community. It allows each person, each individual, each company, each starter, each small little nation of the world to use its great power for innovation, for creativity, and for the newness that we don't even know yet about. So I appreciate the opportunity to be here with so many of the established companies and nations of the world. And I ask you to keep in mind the yet unborn innovator, the young activists who want access to this great, great instrument, this great technology, this great community called the internet, and for the nations of the world that still, two-thirds of the nations of the world, people are still not connected to the internet. Everything and anything we do in the governance must first understand that that's our first priority. So thank you.
Thank you. And now, since I have people behind me who I can't see, Madame Bouvereau, if that's correct.
Yes, thank you. I'm Anne Bouvereau from representing the mobile operators. And the first point I want to say is exactly building on what Cathy said. It's very important to get more people to have access to the internet. We do need to look at governance, absolutely. But the first thing is the internet is mobile in many countries, in China, in Africa. It's actually the way to access the internet. And for all of us, we're all looking at the internet on Wi-Fi or mobile as we go through our daily lives. So I do think that mobile and internet need to be looked at very, very much together. And that's why I'm very happy to be part of the discussion today. The second thing really is, and it's been said by many people, we should definitely use the bodies that exist when they exist. The Internet Governance Forum was mentioned many times by Fadi, by President Ilves, by Klaus Schwab. That's absolutely important. W3C, the Internet Society, the Internet Engineering Task Force, we absolutely need to continue to use these bodies. And ICANN, we haven't said that, but ICANN does a lot of wonderful things. It's very important that we continue the work of the globalization of the ICANN and IANA functions that, Fadi, you have been leading, and we really count on you to continue to lead. So maybe some of the things that we could be doing in this environment, and I think Tim said it really well, is that there are bodies to look at technical aspects, but a technical innovation is never only technical. There will be policy implications. And a policy subject is maybe something from the governance perspective, but will have some technology implications. Data in your country, well, that impacts the way the architecture of the internet is run. So maybe we should be looking at areas where we are at the boundary of something that can be looked upon by a technical standards body or by an existing governance forum, and help direct whether one of them should take the lead or whether we should get them to work together. That certainly is a suggestion. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And now I'll turn to Dr. Hamadoun Touré, Secretary General of the ITU, or the International Telecommunications Union.
Thank you, Mr. President, and good morning to you all. And I would like to thank Professor Klaus Schwab for organizing this great event. I attended NETmundial, representing the UN Secretary General together with Mr. Wu from UNDESA. And we had a common message to the world there. Our message was focused on the fact that we in the UN believe that as a global public good, the internet should be open, fully inclusive, free, reliable, robust, secure, and trustworthy. It should ensure human rights online, and stakeholders from all nations should have a say in its running and development. The internet and the information society will play a key role in delivering social, economic, and environmental sustainable progress in the 21st century, and are a key component of the post-2015 development agenda. Now, I would like to commend the organization of this event here. It is being webcast. And like Kathy just said, it is being webcast. That's a good thing. But it's only 3 billion people that are connected today. There is a whole lot of people who are not connected, who are not accessing the goodies that are coming from this. The focus should be on how to make sure they are connected. But unfortunately, the world has become more dangerous than ever. What's going on? What's wrong with us? We are humans. People are fighting everywhere. Humans are killing one another for ideological, political reasons, many other reasons. What we see in this debate, this is a tool for all the solutions, actually, humankind is facing. Health, transportation, education, Millennium Development Goals, environmental sustainability, the post-2015 development agenda. This will be the solution to all of them. But yet we see the fights that are going on all of these different agendas that are coming in this circle as well. I'm just calling on us, all of us here. We are humans. Let's try to have some dialogue here instead of monologues. I see a lot of monologues. We, at the ITU, we organized the World Summit on Information Society. As a result of that, the IGF came out of it. It's a good platform for dialogue, and we continue to support that. And we'll be in Istanbul next week. But yet we see continuous monologues. We're not listening to one another. How do we make this world a better place? That's my concern. I'm leading this organization since 2007. I'll be ending my term in December this year. I see the world more dangerous than ever before, unfortunately. But there is hope, I believe. I think we should step back and take a deep breath and think, what can we do? The World Economic Forum is providing us wonderful platform. That's why I started attending the WEF since my first year. Klaus was very kind to invite me in January 2007. It was my first week on the job. It was my first trip ever as Secretary General. And I believe that there is a place where, on a low pressure setting, low pressure mode, that we can talk. Let's continue to use those kind of platforms to really try and have real dialogues. But I believe that we need to put some, as Fadi said, some governance here, some rules. Some people would say to us, this should be a place where there is no rule. No rule is also a rule, but it's bad rule. President is asking me to stop here. But I just want to ask you, please, let's have a dialogue. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We just have, if everyone takes too long a time to speak, then there will be people who will not have had the opportunity. I turn to the gentleman in the back. I can't see your name.
Russian Federation. I really thank you for organizing this meeting. And as Russian Federation, we greet and welcome all kind of efforts towards creation, the model of internet as regards of its openness, transparency, and security. We are still on the position that we have to internationalize the internet governance. And in this regards, we are really, thankful to NTIA, US government, and ICANN, in terms of, trying to open and solve this issue on the international level now. When it comes to NETmundial, we appreciate the efforts of Brazil. We understand how tough it was for Brazil, you know, to bring together all different parts, groups, and, you know, well, I still recall these guys with this third translation, those NAMs, I mean, representing this group of that were also expressing their opinion in terms of internet governance. Though we believe that the consensus was not reached at that NETmundial, and it was a rough consensus, though, I mean, many efforts were made on that one, and that is a position of Russia, which hasn't been changed. Though, as said, we really appreciate the efforts of Brazil. In the aftermath of the NETmundial, there was a BRICS gathering. I mean, all the leaders of BRICS countries, they were in Fortaleza. They have again repeated their, you know, will to, in terms of creation, internet, in terms of internet governance, and towards its internationalization. Now, I would really support Mr. Hamadoun Touré, and Russia would like to continue the visas process, which was established after the Tunis conference, which was very fruitful, and I believe led to, you know, eventful kind of, you know, decision that has been made recently during the last years in terms of internet governance. And the last remark is that is not a reproach, but it would be very much appreciated if these kind of events in the future, as we're talking about the inclusivity, would be, as this meeting would be organized in a better way, but because the agenda and the topics and for the discussion, they came up in the very last moment. So it would be very much appreciated that we know the things that we are going to, or we would be going to discuss in advance. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, and let me turn to the gentleman over there who raised his hand.
Thanks, Mr. President. I'd like to express my gratitude and thanks to Fadi, to Dr. Schwab, and to our colleagues from Brazil, because what we are witnessing today is a new era to me by combining the efforts of the ICANN and the platform of the WEF that we all appreciate, how you're becoming very influential at all levels since you started, Mr. Schwab, then the activities of the WEF. That's why we believe that the role the WEF is going to play in full cooperation with all stakeholders for the internet is going to have a great impact. And since I'm representing a country coming from the developing world with a great hope and vision on how internet really can impact the socioeconomic development, as it has been proven, we believe that you are going to play an important role in the next meeting in Davos. We expect that more than 1 billion internet users will be coming from the developing world. So emphasis should be put on the leaders of the developing worlds really to appreciate how internet and how the ICT can play a major role in developing the developing countries. We believe in Egypt, as any other country in Africa and the Middle East, that to really to be able to fight corruption, increase transparency, increase productivity, and really achieve the social equity in true term, this will be through internet and application solutions representing, for example, the health sector, education sector. That's why we believe that we need to work together to change the mindset and to make sure that the power of the internet is going really to be one of the cornerstones for the advancement of the development countries. We need to have a special focus as well in marginalized areas. We need to put special focus on people with disability. These are the noble things that really we can push And I believe through the efforts that have been done through different stakeholders and with the internet governance, we need to move, as we all agreed, from principles to executions. And I think this is the right platform, really, to work on this framework of actions as well. Thanks.
Thank you, Mr. Minister. Actually, I have good news for you that after all of these years, the World Bank has finally decided to do its biannual World Development Report on digitization of developing countries. Maybe not so good news is that I'm the co-author. Mrs. Minister?
Gisela Copper from Costa Rica. I deeply appreciate the invitation to this important forum. Costa Rica, as a world leader in peace, democracy, and human rights protection, of course, will always embrace initiatives like this at NETmundial. And just to let you know, in the last 3 years, Costa Rica has improved the internet connections and users in more than 400% in the last 3 years. So that's really a big increase. And as some colleague already talked about, connectivity is one of our most important issues. But also we have already the multi-stakeholder model. We already used it in last years. We have a steering committee that our government will always discuss any internet issue in this committee. This multi-stake committee is composed by people from the academia, the most four important university of Costa Rica, the government with the Ministry of Science and Technology, Ministry of Economy, the Ministry of Education. The judicial sector also is part of that committee, with the Supreme Court of Justice, the Office of Criminal Investigations. We have the internet regulator, the providers of internet services, the industrial sector as well, and also a representative of the Ombudsman Office. So it's a very broad committee where every discussion is open in there. In fact, this Monday we met just to have the position for Costa Rica in this next week at the IGF meeting. And just to let you know, also we are leaders at the Central American region, and we are having our discussions yet also last week, and we will lead the Central American position at the IGF, also concerning the high quality connectivity, child protection, and cybersecurity as key issues for our region.
Thank you very much. Moving right ahead, Constantin Oranje from Chef de Cabinet of Commissioner Nelly Cruz.
Thank you, Mr. President. Yes, I would like to echo what the Secretary General Touré said, because he's making the point that the world is changing and that the internet, as we know it, and the principles on which it's founded are in a sense not a given. Thus, the challenge before us is not just about ensuring the current governance, but to ensure the internet will continue to exist and deliver as a force for good. And in that sense, the NETmundial conference was an historic event where the importance of the internet and the responsible and global and inclusive governance of the internet was fully acknowledged and subscribed. It's therefore commendable that this initiative seeks to provide effective follow-up to that event and its outcomes, and as such is fully supported by the European Commission. In light of that, we would like to stress as well that the use and the strengthening of the existing fora of internet governance should be the prime focus of our activities. And we should not shy away from the difficulties that we all know are there in trying to organize such governance in complex multi-stakeholder fora. Therefore, I echo what Catherine just said about how this initiative should not distract from the good work that's going on across the internet governance ecosystem, but focus on the new challenges, bringing the internet to new users, making it a platform for new uses as well. And for this process to deliver, it's not just sufficient to bring the bright minds together and the interests that we already know that are involved in internet governance, but it should also deliver a legitimate, transparent, and inclusive as a process, and the process will be key. So that will be, I think, the main challenge for this initiative, is that we have a legitimate process that can deliver legitimate outcomes.
Thank you very much. Now, we're going to have to start closing up. Let me give, I'll give the last word to the Auswärtigesamt, then I'll give first a word to an NGO. Brett Solomon.
Hi. Just to note that there's been 25 speakers, four of whom have been women. So I'm the 21st male speaker. And I think that this raises the issue for me about representation and inclusiveness. And we talk about the multi-stakeholder process. It's not just about companies and governments. It's not just about governments and companies. It's about the involvement of all the stakeholders in the process, which includes civil society, of which there are some representatives here. I think that as WEF goes forward through this process, we need to understand that it is part of the ecosystem, not the only part. I also want to reiterate the point about the primacy of human rights, because I think if we look at the NETmundial document and also what has initiated this process, which is one of privacy, that we need to make sure that human rights sits at the very centre of this discussion, all the way through from the beginning of governance all the way through to the end. And to that point, I wanted to just note the necessary and proportionate principles like the IGF, which is an existing initiative, which should be supported throughout the NETmundial initiative. Thank you.
Let me see. Sir?
Thank you, Mr. President. I'm Norbert Riedel. I'm the Commissioner for International Cyber Policy at the German Foreign Office. We strongly believe that the potential of the internet cannot be realized by one actor or a group of actors alone. Civil society, technical community, private sector and governments need to work together. They all have a role to play, albeit each within their respective competence. And the NETmundial conference in Sao Paulo was indeed a milestone in this respect. As you know, Germany has been an active supporter of NETmundial from the beginning. Participating in the launch of the NETmundial initiative today seemed only natural. That said, we do have some questions with regard to the initiative, its scope, its aims, its setup and funding, the role of human rights. For example, who will take the lead on promoting and fostering the initiative? How do we ensure that the initiative does not duplicate efforts of the IGF? And how can we achieve a maximum of transparency and inclusiveness? Thank you.
Okay, let me just respond to two things. Basically, we do not have a normal a Gaussian distribution of gender here. We have a chi-square distribution, but I will give call upon Eileen Donahue from Human Rights Watch.
Thank you very much. First, let me join others in thanking the organizers and taking up the challenge of trying to follow upon the NETmundial experiment, which was, I think, exceeded most people's expectations in sort of role modeling what multi-stakeholderism can look like as a global process. And I also want to underscore the urgency of this conversation. You know, Tim Berners-Lee brought up that we may be losing the battle of openness and the fragmentation is happening before our eyes. So that's, you know, the context in which these organizers have put this meeting together. Just really briefly to underscore from a human rights point of view, I think the comments by others have mentioned Kathy Brown about access to the technology itself is probably the number one human rights issue. Access to the information, to the infrastructure, to move away from the growing digital divide. It's got to be top priority. And then secondly, underscoring the primacy of human rights, I want to mention, you know, right next to me is the Geneva PERM rep from Sweden, and he, Jan Knudsen, led the initiative at the Human Rights Council in 2012, establishing the foundational principle that human rights must apply online as well as offline in the first UN resolution on this topic. And I think the conversation has to go to the next level in terms of how to apply the rule of law online. It's not just asserting a principle, it's how do we apply the rule of law online. And in that regard, as several others, Carolina, Brett, and others have mentioned, the 13 necessary and proportionate principles lay out a foundation for doing that. Sweden has set out 7 principles where that they're willing to commit to. The US has laid out 6 principles, and I think it's a very important piece of this conversation that's fairly concrete and must be part of the conversation.
Thank you very much, and now we'll move on to the next part of this, and I can gladly hand the microphone over to Rick Simmons, who's Managing Director of the WEF, and he will talk about projects.
Thank you very much, Mr. President, and thanks to all of you. Thus far, we've been having a broad scoping conversation. What should and should not be the focus of this collaborative undertaking, and I think has been very productive. What we thought might be useful is to spend a bit of time on the question of what concrete collaborations or projects might be useful to enable the dialogue and then enable this movement toward an effort to coalesce the expertise and resources that are out there on a distributed basis on specific problems, including particularly with respect to developing country access and governance questions, but others as well. I think this is also a broad scoping conversation. It's to get ideas, suggestions from people of what you think might be useful and interesting. Now, what we thought we'd do just to tee off the conversation in this regard is to invite 4 very quick summaries of some specific notions of such project cooperations in areas that were flagged from these earlier processes, from the panel or from NETmundial itself. And these 4 are not intended, by way of their presentation, to be the exclusive list of such things that we might want to consider collectively. It's just to kind of get our thoughts going. But clearly, there ought to be other types of concrete academic or policy technical types of cooperations that might enable progress. So I would ask each of the 4 just to be very, very brief, maybe a couple of minutes just to summarize. We have some material that goes into a little bit further depth on the screens. And with that, let me start with issue to solution mapping mechanism, Stefan Verhulst of the governance lab at NYU.
Thank you very much, and I'm delighted to be here and to give you an overview of what the plan is with regard to issue to solution to network map. It's about 15 years ago that I moved from Oxford University to New York to become the director of internet governance of a private foundation, and no one knew what internet governance meant at that time. So I always said, let's go to basic and look at what governance means and where it comes from. And to a large extent, as you all know, governance comes from the Latin gobernare, which basically means steering a ship. And so internet governance at that time were defined as steering the further evolution of the internet to make sure that it benefits everyone to a large extent. Now, if you want to steer a ship, then obviously you need a map. And the challenge quite often is that the map is absent, and especially if the territory becomes broader, meaning as Sir Tim indicated, the World Wide Web was generated at the Lac Le Mans, but clearly internet governance is more than Lac Le Mans these days, it's clearly a choppy ocean. And so the question is, how do we actually map the choppy ocean in order to solicit distributed new phase of internet governance? And an attempt to do so is the development of a tool which we call the issue to solution mapping tool that will try to map the issues connected with the current level of solutions that are being proposed, connect that with the people and the organizations that are associated with the solutions and the issues that are comprising internet governance, and do that in a manner that is interactive, do that in a manner that is also visual, and that allows a quick introduction to the issue, so that you deal with quite often the knowledge gap that is present in global discussions, and especially is present in distributed discussions, so that you make sure that everyone quickly can come to a common understanding of the state of an issue, and also a common understanding about who is actually associated with the issue till date. And so we hope that a development of a tool like that, that can cross bridges among issues, but also among actors, that such a tool can allow for identification of opportunities of collaboration, can allow for opportunities to coordinate in certain areas, but also allows for identification of new participants and new issues that to a large extent might be orphaned or might already have been dealt with in a particular way. And so in the moment, at the current moment, we are in the development stage, and we clearly need everyone's input and help to make this a tool that is user-friendly for everyone in the internet governance page, whether that relates with the kind of languages that we need to use, whether that relates with the kind of topics that needs to be covered, or whether it relates with the kind of interactivity that is required for that. And so the design principles that we apply obviously are focused on the user, while at the same time be lean, and while at the same time be agile, but also we hope that this will be co-created, and that also it will be as transparent as today has been. Thank
Excellent.
You.
Thank you very much. Just as a reminder, these are initial notions. We're going to solicit more detailed information about them, post this for comment more widely, not just among this group, but more widely in the international community, and get some specific feedback and guidance, not only for this, for us here as a process, but for the people who are actually putting the ideas together. Next, may I invite Urs Gasser, who's the Executive Director for Best Practice for Distributed Governance Groups. He's the Executive Director of the Berkman Center, actually, at Harvard. Urs?
Thank you so much. I'm delighted to be here, not only in my capacity as the Executive Director of the Berkman Center, but perhaps more excitingly and importantly, also as the liaison to a global network of internet and society centers that brings together over 30 research centers from around the world, including 10 centers from the Global South and many women, actually. Something that is very important, exactly. So together we launched an academic pilot research project that seeks to contribute systematically and from a diverse perspective to the current debate about the future of an internet governance ecosystem. This global collaboration is grounded in the strong belief that academic research is a necessary resource for stakeholders and initiatives such as the one here, the NETmundial initiative. As a first step and as a proof of concept, we are focusing on fleshing out what is meant by distributed governance groups, a term and a concept introduced by the high-level panel. We try to look beyond the examples we are already familiar with. Some have been mentioned this morning. We do that through a series of case studies from various countries, focusing on lessons learned, contextual good and best practices. Examples include the German Enquete Commission, CGIBR, and especially how it dealt with the spam problem, the Turkish Internet Improvement Board, and since we're in Switzerland, I also want to mention the ComCom roundtables in the context of fiber to the home issues. Next slide, please. So where we are in this process, we will present draft case studies on October 2nd at an academic symposium at the University at the Politecnico di Torino. Please check out our website, networkofcenters.net, if you'd like to be involved. This is an open invitation to everyone. We are also working on a synthesis document that we hope to present later this year that distills some of the lessons learned across the 12 case studies I mentioned, and work with many other academic partners, including GigaNet and the Research Advisory Network to the Global Commission, on a future future research agenda for a next phase in our collaboration. I have a number of questions, but I fear I'm running out of time. Just to throw one out, please be in touch if you have ideas how we can make research most relevant to you, to the world at large, where we can share the outcomes of our research, be it the IGF best practice forums, in addition, of course, to this initiative here. Thank you very much.
Thank you. This is a potentially good example of what a number of you mentioned earlier. One potential utility of this exercise is to identify best or leading practice and facilitate its wider application. In that respect, Minister Almeida, would you like to comment on the best practices for local multi-stakeholder internet governance structures, a project that the CGI in Brazil has been pioneering?
Well, thank you again for inviting me to talk about the CGI. CGI is the Internet Governance Body of Brazil. It is interesting because, as someone said here, Internet governance is in permanent evolution. And so the CGI is also in a permanent evolution. And I'm going to show what are the main characteristics of the CGI. It was created 20 years ago when the internet had maybe a few millions users. So everything is different from the date it was created. And the vision at that time was to promote internet governance initiatives in a regional and country level driven by the needs and practices of local multi-stakeholders. And can you move next? So that's the architecture of CGI. It is a multi-stakeholder model that has 21 representatives, 9 from government, 4 from private sector, 4 from NGOs or non-profit sector, and 4 from scientific and academic community. And it was created initially in 1995, 20 years ago. And then it had a presidential decree that changed the way that the representatives are appointed to the CGI. So government members are appointed by ministers, and the rest of the members are elected by their constituencies. And you can note, if you look at the numbers, that no single stakeholder has the majority of the votes, even government. It's not simple to accept that, but that's the way that it was created. And it takes a lot of time, a lot of effort to convince the members of the CGI to get a decision. So this is one point that we should try to improve in the future. The multi-stakeholder decision model is not simple, that one thing. But the decisions last for a long time and are accepted by the society. Another interesting aspect is that when this model was created, the main concern was to include in this committee representatives from ministries that at that time dealt with infrastructure questions. Now we see that maybe it's time to think of replacing some representatives, because as President Ilves said, we need to include there a representative from the Minister of Justice, a representative from the Minister of Culture, a representative from other sectors that are important and are affected by the internet. So that another interesting observation is that the way that we see in the CGI model has suffered several modifications along the time. So when we look at the model today and we understand how it works, we can get very good outcomes of it. We forget to say that there were several changes to the spirit of the CGI. So one thing that I said to Fadi, this is a Brazilian model. It can be used as an inspiration. It can help other countries to create their own models, but they have to work on their specific model that takes into consideration so the local society, the local culture, and the local economy. So we can work with other countries, providing some knowledge, transferring technology, but they have to construct their specific model. And also that this committee is not only the 21 members, it has several centers associated with this, with the CGI. There is a center for internet security, another one for producing statistics for the cyberspace. There's another one, it's the WTC member. So there are several centers that make the link between technology and policies, technological people and politicians. So we have this structure that helps to create this connection. And finally, one important thing is that the Brazilian law for the internet, for the rights on the internet, was born in the CGI, in the discussions of CGI that proposed 7 years ago what we call the principles for the internet, and that was the inspiration for the members of the parliament to construct the Brazilian, the Marco Civil, which is the Brazilian law. So that's one experience that we can show some important points and also some weakness to help other countries to construct their own models. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Finally, Fadi, would you like to discuss a bit the toolkit for internet cooperation and governance that ICANN is looking into?
Sure. I want to just put some context. We've just seen three project proposals. I'm about to present a fourth one, but it's important that we anchor these projects into the NETmundial statement and the ILVES initiative. Every one of these projects was actually a recommendation in these reports. So these are projects that stem from our desire to take these statements and turn them into actions, into moving to starting to solve problems. And the first one was critical, connecting issues to solutions. We don't want people standing up again in major global forums and saying, how do I solve spam? There are many ways to solve spam. They exist today. We just need them connected, so people can quickly find the solutions and act on them. The second project you heard from Professor Ursgasser is related to the ILVES report. President ILVES report recommended a distributed model of governance, but we don't have real research on how a distributed model of governance works. So Harvard, with its network of centers, will start thinking through how do we form these distributed governance networks? What rules do they use? How does consensus work? This is important research that will aid us to advance. The third project we just heard from CGI is also a recommendation of both reports. Some countries are already starting to copy, if I could be direct, the Brazilian model of CGI, a superb model. But even as the minister said, it may not be perfect for every country. Lebanon just changed its laws and established its first multi-stakeholder internet governance committee based on the Brazilian model. There could be others, and the generosity of Brazil to offer a project to help us share their best practices is a good thing, and it will help others. This fourth and last project was also a recommendation from the reports. And ICANN is willing to facilitate and help in that particular project. What is this one? So now these new governance groups get created. They're distributed. They're independent. They need toolkits. They need software tools. They need best practices so that they can do the work of internet governance. So we're proposing, with Jim sitting in front of me as the last CEO of SAP, we're proposing an ERP for internet governance. We're proposing a platform that allows any group wishing to do internet governance in a distributed way to have a tool set for doing dialogue, for doing sharing of documents, for managing workflow between them, for ensuring transparency. We essentially are proposing an open source platform available to any governance group in the world that wishes to come together and form either standards, specifications, or best practices. And we would like to start the work and resource, and hopefully all these projects, not just the one ICANN is proposing, with your input and with your help over the next few months, can start showing some fruits of success and advancement by the time we finish this six-month period. I'm going to make a bold step, if it's okay with you, Rick. We've heard a lot of comments today about a project that did not show up amongst these four. And I'd like to propose a fifth project, just to propose. And it's something Professor Schwab and I had discussed. Many of you talked about access. I propose a fifth project that with the great convening and resource power of the World Economic Forum, that we convene a lot of people to connect the next billion people to the internet. And I believe you could help us with that, Dr. Schwab, if I could put you on the spot here. But this could be, we heard a lot of people speak about access. What do you think?
We certainly have to walk the talk, which means we had many, many excellent suggestions. We had great contributions. I think every organization, every individual can contribute. We have now to make sure that in the next 6 months, as you said, we go forward and we really move from issue identification to possible solutions. And I want to offer here the next annual meeting in Davos, which certainly will bring together again 40 heads of states and governments and the business leadership, the heads of the civil NGOs, civil society, the young people, I should mention the young people who are, and academics. And I feel many of the ideas which we have discussed today should have been cast in a more concrete form when we meet again in Davos. And what I can promise is that on that occasion, a major part of Davos will be devoted to the future of the internet. But I would like to add, because I'm speaking here as someone who has been so much involved in integrating the developing the emerging countries into the global community. I think to move, we heard this morning that only one-third of the world minister is connected, actually, and we spoke a lot about access. We absolutely have to make sure that in addition to all the issues which we discussed, this single issue, giving access to every single human being, because the internet will be the key factor in many areas, education, health, as we heard, transportation, food security. I'm just quoting some of the projects which we have underway in the forum. It will be crucial for countries in terms of their competitiveness, innovativeness, but it will be crucial for each human being, and here I should add, crucial also in terms of the preservation of his or her human dignity.
Well, I'll open up for comments on the projects. Anyone? Chris Painter, yes.
So thank you for all of this discussion. I think perhaps one of the potentially broadest of those projects, and one that will be certainly of interest to many people in the world, including the developing world, is the issue to solution mapping. And because of the potential broadness, I think it's very important to engage a very wide community, not just of the traditional internet governance community, but also stakeholders who are involved in security policy, other issues, within governments and even outside of governments. So that's a challenge in terms of engaging that wider community. because often in these discussions what we have represented are in the governments, ministries of communications, and not that full range of stakeholders. So I think it's important to do that. I'd also say that that two things about that. One is that, you know, there are a lot of, as Fadi said, there are a lot of solutions already out there, and a lot of the people in the world don't know those solutions are out there, and sometimes they're regional solutions, and we don't need one ring to rule them all necessarily, or one institution to rule them all, but we can point people to distributed solutions, and I think that's important. And then that can also provide a link to something that also helps a lot of the world community, which is capacity building, and that's something we should think about in that context as well.
Thank you. I'll give someone there, and then I'll go back on this side.
Thank you, Mr. President. I'm Jovan Kurbali. I'm director of Diplo Foundation and head of Geneva Internet Platform, a newly established space for discussion on internet governance issues. First of all, congratulations for this really exciting and new initiatives. I would like just to make a few updates on the ongoing processes that could contribute to this mapping exercise. One is the exercise of the Commission of Science and Technology for Development. There is an identification of close to 200 IG issues. I'm involved in this process of mapping that within the Commission. And there is also a Global Internet Policy Observatory initiative of a few institutions that aims to increase the evidence-based internet governance. Therefore, it is great that we have this opportunity to make some sort of inventory and to combine the efforts and to avoid the duplication of efforts in the way to make internet governance more effective, inclusive, and legitimate, as it has been stressed quite a few times. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. Firstly, let me thank you, Prof, for convening us here, I think, in this great event and Geneva's weather. I think, I don't know where, who bought it. It's a beautiful weather today. I think I just wanted to add to two things. One is convening, I mean, putting this agenda as one of the main topics in January would really be a great thing. Thank you for that. Secondly, I would also request if you could add it in your event in Africa, I think in May or June of next year. It would be very important because awareness is something that is very critical. Those of us who are here, I think we move with speed in addressing these issues. I think it's important to recognize that the global leadership, both in politics and economy, sometimes are behind the curve when it comes to these issues. And therefore, bringing them along is very, very critical. I think WEF is one great platform to do that. So I think toolkits at one level would be very, very important to almost be used to permeate almost to local level. But I think, in my view, also making the leadership of the world aware of this issue is a very, very important issue. I think there is a big gap between those who understand this content and these issues and the general leadership that is involved in global issues or debates in different forums. I think that gap is the one that sometimes creates conflict. So I just want to add that the issue of toolkit and development is very critical, in particular for the African continent. Africa has 1 billion people out of the 7 billion people that we have in the world. Thank you.
There's a woman there who had her hand up. Hello? You had your hand up.
So I was told by surprise because it was a while ago.
Yeah, and it's interesting talking after having seen the slides of the projects, because we hadn't had the chance. But by the way, thank you very much. I hereby represent the Italian government, and as you know, since the process of Sao Paulo, we've been very much interested in building a bridge between the Internet Governance Forum and the talks and the participatory process which takes place there to other processes whereby all the stakeholders and the Brazilian model is very much interesting and potential, can have a say in turning problems, talks, concerns into possible solutions that can be spread out. What is really worrying is the fragmentation that can take place in the internet environment. And it is the main concern that even as the present presidency of the European Union semester would like to tackle as Italian government, and we will be hosting an informal meeting next October with all the member states of the European Union to understand how, as a continent and as a union, we can help fighting the problem of possible fragmentation and non-multi-stakeholder process in the future of the internet governance. So we very much welcome this initiative, and we're very much interested in taking active part in it. And as the German colleague said before, we're very much looking forward to understand better the scope and how and the methodologies and processes whereby we can help. And having seen this first attempt, it's been very useful. So, well, we're happy work to all of us, because there's much ahead to do, and the process to the Davos meeting is very short, so we probably need to rush up and understand how we can put this into action. Thank you.
Jim Snobbett.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. I'd like to add one comment in terms of urgency and need for speed. I think we've established that we all agree the internet is very important currently and probably even more so in the future. We have established that there are significant issues that need resolution. It's very nice to see that there are good practices already happening and methodologies. So there is an opportunity to progress, and it seems like we're all eager to contribute. So that's all good news. I think the world has been in a similar situation many times before. We started moving goods around in the world, and then in order to do that in secure and transparent ways, we agreed on rules for how can you move ships from one location to the other in international waters, and what can you do in containers. We then went to moving people around, and we have aviation now internationally regulated. Even though it's a very risky business, it seems to be managed in a very a consistent way globally. And now we're at a stage where we will be moving digital information around the world. We're already doing it, yet we have never really governed it in a way that it should, given its importance. And the reason that I wanted to add the importance of speed is that the biggest difference between, you know, container goods and people is that the evolution and the innovation when you are in a digital world is so rapid. And I would argue that if we are not having an ambition to be even faster than the innovation itself, then we will not be able to ever contribute to this, because it'll move faster and faster than we. And so while I am a big fan of ideal solutions, I think we need in the effort to be pragmatic, we need to be rapidly moving forward, and we should find the quick wins that we can and not wait for the perfection that is needed eventually, because otherwise we will run out of time. Thank you.
Thank you. And from the Organization of African States?
My name is Pierre Ouedraogo. I am from the Organisation Internationale de la Francophonie. And I want to thank WEF for the invitation. President Abdou Diouf couldn't come, but we welcome the ICANN and Brazil proposal, and we are ready to work with them to have it to be implemented in 2015. Sharing best practices is very critical, as many have said before. But this is more critical in Africa in order to help to build local internet ecosystem. If we don't have local internet ecosystem, we cannot participate at the global level. This is the first thing to do. And that's why we have been conducting last year a strategic study in Chad with ITU, ICANN, ISOC, IFRENIC, and we went together, and this is a kind of dialogue that Amadou was talking about, because those four organizations have been working together, so it is more efficient and sustainable, and also we can optimize the resources. So what I would say is that for those initiatives, it is necessary to consider multi-organization coordinated action in order to optimize the resources and be more efficient, going together through dialogue. Thank you, Mr. President.
Does EFF have its hand up, or is it just writing?
Thank you very much. Jeremy Malcolm from the Electronic Frontier Foundation, though I'm speaking off the cuff, so I'm not going to say that it's in an EFF capacity. So one of the stated purposes for today's agenda was to shape or further shape the terms of reference for the NETmundial initiative. And it strikes me that the four proposals for projects seem to presuppose that the terms of references have already been agreed by the global multi-stakeholder community and are pretty much closed for discussion. Namely, there are two contributions that it's been posited that the initiative could take. One of them is a policy dialogue that cuts across border communities of experts and leaders than are available in traditional internet governance institutions. And the second one is to support capacity building for developing countries. But now in the last 15 minutes, a third one seems to have emerged, which is support for promoting access. Now, access is already being the focus of a number of initiatives elsewhere. Is this a new part of the terms of reference for the NETmundial initiative? And if so, what is the process that we're going to collectively undertake to finalise the terms of reference here today? Likewise, are the projects also closed? We've heard four projects, and then suddenly again a fifth project has been proposed. All of these seem to have come together in a fairly top-down fashion. And fairly pre-cooked proposals that have been presented to us sort of on a plate. So my question is, how does the grassroots internet community come up with proposals that could fit into the NETmundial framework, if at all? Because if this is going to be a long-term process, I think that needs to be seen to be possible rather than things coming down very hierarchically. So to give one example, something that's missing from any of the proposals or from the terms of reference is any norm-setting capacity for the NETmundial initiative. Now, maybe that's something that we don't want to be part of the initiative, but I'll just point out that that was one of the unique contributions of the NETmundial meeting, the fact that whereas the IGF had not been able to produce any significant outputs, the NETmundial meeting was able to produce a set of very useful principles in a very short space of time. So might we want to consider that the NETmundial initiative could also provide a forum for the development of consensual multi-stakeholder soft law recommendations? So that's just one example of something that we might decide the NETmundial initiative should do, and I'm being told that I've run out of time. So that's a question that I have. What is the process for finalising the terms of reference and the projects?
Last but very short statement from back there.
Ben Hampson from the Global Commission on Internet Governance, co-sponsored by the Center for International Governance Innovation in Canada and Chatham House in London, chaired by Swedish Foreign Minister Carl Bildt. A lot of references to the fragmentation issue, and I should say that the Commission is looking at this problem in considerable depth. We have a research advisory network that is tackling this problem. Six projects underway on fragmentation alone, trying to get a sense of the shape of the problem, because there are many different aspects of fragmentation, developing fragmentation scenarios where you can assign costs to different scenarios, and thirdly, trying to develop or identify appropriate policy responses, cooperative solutions to those different scenarios. We will be happy to share that work, to feed it into the work of this forum and other forums. The Commission is completely independent, but it is global in scope in terms of its membership. It's highly interdisciplinary. It's not the usual suspects. And the research advisory network that is supporting the work of the Commission is also global in terms of its membership, has a very strong developing country focus to its work, to its membership. And again, the members of the RAN, as we call it, will be happy to share their work as it's completed. Thank you.
Let me first make a couple of comments here about the process going forward. Then I see Minister Almeida would like to speak, and then we'll hand it back to you, Mr. President. So this has been framed as a scoping discussion. And even as the questions posed in the agenda indicate, we haven't yet bound it by any sense, either the scope of the dialogue, the policy dialogue, or what particular types of enabling research or other projects would be helpful. These were presented, as I said at the beginning, as illustrations of initial things that are being prepared because they flow out of earlier processes. But specifically, this is open to other suggestions. And so, as I mentioned, we will post what we have on these initial ideas for a wider comment. We'll seek more explicitly other notions on other aspects of things that aren't so much best practice or governance related. It may relate to collective action possibilities to improve access or otherwise. So that's the spirit of today, if you will. Going forward today, we will have a press conference to announce the first step in this process, if you will. And then later, as you will have seen in the agenda at 4:30, we'll begin to move from scoping of issues and notions to how do we begin to organize and bound and focus the exercise. And that too will be open, a webcast. We'll be trying to get a tighter conversation, but there'll also be open meetings. So anybody who's still here at that time that wants to be in that meeting and potentially provide some input will have an opportunity to do so. And let me say finally, in terms of process, that we intend for there to be a series of conversations and discussions going forward about the various pieces here, the policy issues, what might be useful, collective action undertakings, i.e. particular projects, and then more widely, the larger question, which we haven't gotten to yet today in this session, about what should be the ultimate or evolving configuration of this cooperative exercise. Would it benefit from some greater structure? If so, in what form? Should it not be a structure? Should it be a sort of variable geometry set of configurations that help the thing move that forward? That's an open question. We'll specifically put that on the table for input and conversation later today as we try to move a little bit toward from the what to the how we organize this initiative. So that's the spirit of this. With that, let me suggest, Mr. President, that we invite Minister Almeida to make his a point, and then we'll draw the meeting to a close.
That's a small suggestion concerning the processes. I would suggest to create a multi-stakeholder committee for each problem to oversee the evolution of each of the projects. That worked very well in the construction of the NETmundial conference. In a balanced multi-stakeholder committee for each project.
Thank you very much. I thank you all for being here, and we'll just conclude this session for now. Thank you.